Let us pray. Gracious Lord, as you shared so much wisdom with your disciples all those years ago, be with each of us now, Lord. Open our hearts and our minds. Inspire us to hear your words and your will for our lives and act upon them, that together we might all be able to share that the kingdom of heaven has come here. Amen. This morning, I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the differences between the world in which you and I live in and the world in which the gospel writer Matthew is writing. You know, Shirley and I were just talking last week about retirement, trying to figure out how much money we're going to need to survive and to utilize when we're going to get on Social Security and take that money, which we already shared with our government. But in the day of that this gospel is being written, there was no such thing as Social Security. The closest thing that there was to Social Security was that you all had families. And traditionally, within this culture, the eldest son would take over the family business. Education wasn't that big of a priority in this world. Children would go to school as very young children, but by the age of 10, sons would leave school in order to take up apprenticeship with their father in order to take over the family business. And as friends got more successful in their business ventures, they would invite other friends to join them. So, for example, we hear stories of the fishermen on the Sea of Galilee. Many of these families worked together to make catches of fish so that there was a more abundant catch to share with the community in which they lived. And this is really the society and the culture in which Matthew is writing for you and I today. If you recall, at the beginning of Matthew's gospel, he calls Jesus Emmanuel. God is with us. Jesus is told to have come to our world in human flesh to support the family business, to teach the world in which he lived about God's unconditional love for humanity, to preach and exhort the people in that culture about forgiveness, about grace, and about mercy, to speak and to demonstrate compassion for others, to share what you had with each other in abundance with those who had little, to bring a word of liberation to all those people who felt oppressed. This was the family business to which Jesus entered into humanity. After what was sure to have been an exhausting day just prior to our gospel reading, Jesus had just finished proclaiming what we call the Sermon on the Mount. He comes into this town and sees absolute throngs of people clamoring to be close to have their diseases and their sicknesses healed. And instead of our Lord being frustrated, instead of our Lord being angry, instead of our Lord being too tired, the gospel writer Matthew shares with us, you and I, that as Jesus looked upon the throngs of people, that he had great compassion on them. That he saw those people as sheep who were in need of shepherds. And so, Jesus turns to his closest friends, his disciples, and he commissions them to join in the now thriving family business. The disciples, who were instinctively and by nature incredibly different from one another. We have a disciple in Matthew who was a Roman tax collector sitting at the same table as Simon the Canaanite, who was a known zealot. That would be akin to you and I today as having the President of the United States sitting at a table with a member of ISIS. You have people from diverse backgrounds coming together around this common theme of teaching and preaching, healing and liberation as part of Christ's family business. Fast forward now 2,000 years to the days that you and I live in, and we wonder what's going on with that family business. And the truth is that in the waters of our baptism, each one of us has been called, gathered, enlightened by the Holy Spirit to actually participate and be part of the family business. To be part of this family business that has been part of God's will for humanity since the beginning of all time. For much of our larger church's storied history, the words that we spoke and taught on Sunday did not necessarily match the family's business slogan that God pursues you with unrelenting and passionate love in every circumstance, in every moment of our life. For much of our larger church's storied history, we have brought an almost robotic conformity in our understanding of what is necessary for unity instead of celebrating diversity that is focused on an individual understanding of God, sharing that understanding within the world, and offering a compassionate and healing hand, the word of liberation to all people who feel oppressed. For much of the larger church's history, leaders have been more concerned with pretense and social acceptance rather than meeting those communities that truly promoted healing and liberation within the rank and file of her members. When people look at us and see in our lives that our actions are not consistent with the words that we speak, they begin to lose trust. They begin to lose belief that the words that are spoken, that we speak on a weekly basis, make any difference in the world in which you and I live. When pain and suffering in everyday life is not focused on God's family business of teaching, of preaching, of healing and liberation, people within the world put their faith and their trust on a mantle above their fireplace and simply look at it on Sunday morning, or pull it off the shelf a few times a year, and they never begin to act on their faith or live their lives in a manner consistent with the business to which they have been called. When you and I are not living within the joyful participation of our family's business, we may forget that our Heavenly Father desires that we are even part of that business. We may not feel as if we were ever really received an invitation from God to fully be part of the business to which we have been called. This morning, the kingdom of God has drawn near to you. Because this morning, our Lord and Savior invites each and every one of you to become part of the family business. Go ahead now and open those letters that you got. See, I'm going to do like John Carson used to do on the Tonight Show. Okay? This morning, each one of you has received an invitation to be part of the family business. Because God has wonderfully created each and every one of you. God has enlightened each and every one of you with gifts of the Holy Spirit to teach others about your understanding of God, to proclaim that the kingdom of God has drawn near in this time and in this place, and to act on those things that you believe, to fully participate in the business which is at hand. To share with the world and proclaim with the world that God loves this world by telling it to one heart at a time. This is the family business to which you and I have been called. Along the way, Matthew shares with us that Emmanuel, our God, walks with us. That God walks beside us and among us and within us. Our God shares with you. Don't allow the many voices in the world around you that tell you that you're not worthy, that tell you that you have no intrinsic value, that try to share with you that you are not confident in your own faith, that try to tell you that you can't do what's necessary to be a leader within the family business. God shares with us, don't allow those voices to take away the invitation that our Lord freely, willfully, and joyfully extends to us all. For our God has wonderfully created us. Our God has called each one of you worthy. Our God has shared that you have intrinsic value. Our God has invited each one of us with special gifts of the Holy Spirit and promised to remain with us forever. I happen to have one good authority. Our God knows each one of you and is especially fond of you. Amen.